Yeah, there you go.
Good evening, Mayor Harvey, members of council, members of our community. So we have a scheduling, not dilemma, but a challenge right now. Our executive session had anticipated the participation of our city engineer, Jason Morris, to talk about prospective litigation. He was just called out to the area near Clinton Street where there's a suggestion that there is a spill of either diesel fuel or oil. So as soon as we hear back from him, I think our executive session would be more useful if we waited for Jason on that. Okay. And so the question is, to what extent we can proceed through the agenda if any of the other participants have anticipated a delay in their usual executive session that starts at the beginning.
I've told people who I've invited to do a presentation to come at 7.
Okay. Right. On so, number 2 on that agenda for the students, they were actually supposed to be at our regular on December 10th.
Yeah, so and that's this is council meeting presentation.
Oh.
So there's 2 presentation sections on the agenda. So the first section is reminders for what we expect to be on Monday night's agenda, except for the executive session. That's the only way Naomi could rework it when the request was to do executive session first thing.
Yeah. So I left all of my material downstairs thinking we were going there.
Well, there. Okay. So there is one item or 2 items that we could do executive session twice.
We can get started.
We could go
and maybe Jason will come along, and then this way we'll be in sync. Okay, so then with that being said, do we have a motion to go into executive session?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Okay.
Maybe I'll talk to him.
Okay, we want to thank the members of our community and those in attendance this evening for your patience. Yes, right. Can we have a motion, please, to come out of executive session?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. So we'll move on then to item number 2, and that's a presentation from my brother's keeper, fellows from the Newburgh and Large School District regarding a $1 million grant. Councilman Grice, do you want to introduce?
So that's actually for Monday's agenda item. Those students will be coming, and they're working on a sprint grant. It's to get access to Wi-Fi hotspots in their houses. So it'd be those scholars, and they'll present it. And so I don't want to steal their thunder too much, but I guarantee you it will be something to watch.
Okay, good. Item 3 is a proclamation presented to the McLemore family. Would any member, Mayor, you'd like to speak to that?
Yeah, so I thought it was appropriate. First of all, thanking Councilwoman Rayford for her efforts in organizing the street naming ceremony we had. It was a wonderful success, and I think everyone was in attendance from the council and the community with regard to naming Chamber and First Street Macklemore Square. So I thought it would be appropriate to put those efforts in writing and issue proclamations for Michael Macklemore, Reverend Robert Macklemore Sr., and also offering the same proclamation to Mary Macklemore and doing that, just so that what we did on this past weekend would be put in an official record and documented with a proclamation in writing. So
I would agree.
I just have to ask a question. With the information that I had submitted to you, corporate counsel, would that be also on the proclamation as it has in the past, similar to?
The first I heard of this was today, so I have not shared any information. you know, the resolution, the information in the resolution certainly could be incorporated into the proclamation. That's okay. Entirely up to the mayor and the council.
Okay. Any other questions, comments?
Yeah, what information specifically?
Well, it was just indicating all the achievements and accomplishments.
Oh, yeah, you know. That's fine. Yeah.
That could easily.
So we'll require that tomorrow or Monday? We already have it.
Yeah, they've
okay.
been drafting
Very
it. Very
good. Thank you. Nothing further on item 3. Then we'll move along to item 4, and that relates to our public hearing scheduled for this Monday's meeting relating to the residency requirement, City Charter C3.12.
So just as a brief reminder, the public hearing relates to a textual amendment that would address a change in the waiver requirement where there is a recruiting issue for a particular officer covered by this provision if to grant a broader or more permanent waiver based on an individual appointment to an individual position. So that's the subject matter of the local law that's for the public hearing on Monday.
So the question I have is, how often do we have to have a public hearing regarding a residency policy that we have? Because I know we just had one not too long ago.
So every time a local law is proposed, a public hearing has to be scheduled in order for that local law to be considered for adoption. You can only amend local laws by local laws. So at the last work session and council meeting, what we had discussed was subsequent local law number 1 of 2015 that was adopted in January had raised some questions among the staff. And in August of 2017, two amendments were proposed at that time. One was to extend the exemption for current city department heads to current city employees. The second was to broaden the waiver provision so that it could be granted for more than 90 or 120 days. In 2017, there was no interest in considering any of those amendments, so nothing occurred. Earlier this year, there was some concerns about employees who had sought or had been promoted internally to department head positions who didn't have the benefit of that original exemption. And at that point, the local law with both amendments was introduced. There was support for the exemption, but not for the waiver expansion. So a local law was adopted in October that expanded the exemption to cover existing city employees who get promoted into department head positions. But as we discussed 2 weeks ago, we have run into a hiring problem in the position of plumbing inspector. The plumbing inspector was appointed to a different position within the city, went from the plumbing inspector to a position in the water department. The plumbing inspector position is currently vacant. There's been a posting and a recruiting effort that took place. There were three applicants, as I understand it. Two were city residents and declined to take the job. There was a third interested party who was not a city resident, who it was interested in the job, but was not did not want to have to be required to become a city resident. And so there was a request to reintroduce the waiver provision amendment. And in trying to address the recruiting issues that we have for this particular provision, this amendment was represented as a new local law, and a resolution was adopted to schedule the public hearing for Monday night, and that's where we are in the process.
Thank you.
And with regard to that third candidate who was interested but was not willing to relocate, he ultimately rejected. Even though he'd represented that we were going to come to council to petition for the waiver on the residency, He rejected on the basis that he felt there was insufficient pay. He's got a more competitive opportunity. And speaking with the group about this further, I really do think that this could be a long-term challenge for us that is really going to thwart our efforts for economic development if we can't come up with an alternative. When I asked Michelle Kelson about can we go with a third-party contractor, there's a state of New York law that says you have to have this. Cities have to have it, but surrounding towns and villages do not. She is continuing to research whether there might be some opportunity for us to duplicate the model for the electrical inspectors, which does enable us to have outside contractors assisting us in the inspection services. No such exemption exists, though, for the plumbers. So Chief Horton went out and conducted a survey of other municipalities and what are they doing. It turns out there's a number of cities that are held to this requirement that simply have not been able to locate plumbing inspectors. So it's somewhat analogous to the 1A water license. It's one way in which I believe the state of New York needs to change the paradigm, because these folks, these plumbers out there, can earn a heck of a lot more money working as a contractor than being a plumbing inspector. And we were fortunate to have someone of Ed's caliber and knowledge available to do the inspection work. So this could be something that's protracted for us in terms of being able to actually get a plumbing inspector. We've spoken to Chief Horton about the possibilities of training in-house. The challenge there is that it's a very specialized area. It's very technical. You almost have to have the knowledge of a cardiologist to be able to really do plumbing properly. There's so much more to it than anyone realizes. So I've spoken also to Mr. Donat about this in terms of one of the long-term challenges that we're going to have. So even if we exempt or waive the residency, I don't want to portray it as being the panacea that's going to suddenly make a plumbing inspector appear here. We're still going to have a long-term challenge if we're measuring it against the challenges the other communities are having in being able to locate and secure plumbing inspectors.
What I want to make clear, though, is the proposed local law does not automatically grant a waiver for any particular provision. What this particular amendment does is require the city to go through a recruiting effort to make sure that, at least in the first instance, that we've exhausted the possibility of hiring somebody who is currently a city resident or is willing to become a city resident. And then, depending on what your recruiting situation is, the waiver, a waiver from the residency requirement can be granted on a case-by-case basis on a longer term than what existed in the current iteration of the local law. So okay. We're not exempting any blanket exemptions from any positions. There has to be a recruiting process and documentation under the proposed amendment before a waiver could be granted.
And what I do want to point out is that Ed Howard right now is wearing two hats. He's working in a half capacity as a water supervisor because he's continuing, to his credit, to perform as many of the plumbing inspections as possible.
Okay. Yeah,
but
that was
we're still delayed. Chief Horton will represent, we're still behind schedule. And as a testament to yet one more employee's dedication to this community, Ed won't say it, but I will, that he's actually earning less money now than he was when he was originally a plumbing inspector. But he rose to the challenge that we needed the supervisor position filled in water. And he's right now straddling both jobs, and he's actually going backwards financially in order to serve the community.
I'm concerned because when we look at development projects that are ongoing currently as we speak, we got to get the plumbing inspectors, got to get that person to allow these developers to move forward. In addition to that, I had a meeting with the Landlord Association and a few landlords who also raised the issue and concern with the plumbing inspector, even when Mr. Howard, I believe it is, was
the plumber too.
Right. So. Yeah. It was limited in terms of when he was available, And I think it was once, I guess on Fridays or something like that, and limited hours when he could. So he was even overwhelmed before he went into being the supervisor in the water department.
Right.
So if we're talking about moving the city forward, revitalizing, we really got to do something immediate to address this issue.
We're looking at a couple of different things. So there's things that the general city law requires, which is a state law. We can't
get around that.
We can't get around that at the present time. It wouldn't be the first time that the city was requesting that the state revisit the necessity of those provisions in the state law. We know that other cities are struggling with the same recruiting issues and the same retention issues. We are looking to see what, if it's possible to maybe restructure some of the positions and some of the duties and responsibilities so that perhaps the core things that really do require technical expertise of a journeyman plumber are reserved for that particular position, but other duties and responsibilities that maybe could be performed by a code enforcement officer or some similar position might be reassigned through an appropriate process.
So is there a possibility of having Mr. Howard do the plumbing inspecting full time until we find someone?
Again, this is a metaphor, or emblematic rather, of the challenges we have at City Hall. In doing that, then, we create a yawning gap in the water supervision position. And there, we continue to have challenges in meeting all the emergencies and infrastructure failures. So for right now, I think the best of both worlds is for Ed to do both, but it's not going to satisfy us on either end.
So did when you guys met together, what was the discussion around, sort of in the mode of striking while the iron is hot, if this individual was interested at first, and maybe one of his potential areas for not being as interested aside from the city residency was salary, did you guys discuss upping the salary so that we at least have this short term?
So the salary is fixed by contract. It's a CSCA position. That would, potentially facing a contract reopener. And if you're going to entertain that for CCA, the PBA has asked for a contract reopener. That would open the door for other unions. And that would you can't just unilaterally change the salary.
Okay.
But as a measure of the appeal in the other communities that Chief Horton had reached out to, even where there was a higher salary available, it still hasn't attracted a plumbing inspector. And so in those instances, it's actually the building inspector, the chief building official in those cities that's doing the plumbing inspection at a much higher rate. In this instance, Chief Horton is not looking to do that because it's going to pull him away from a plethora of other responsibilities.
All right. Michael, that head of building department is vacant, the position, correct? Still?
The supervisor position is for the billing department?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that in the budget that I proposed for next year, that supervisor position has been eliminated to a regular code enforcement officer. It is a way to save money and also give Chief
so
Horton,
Chief Horton is
the opportunity. He's effectively post. Supervising under Chief Ayler's direction.
Great.
So it's one of those, when we had the discussion on the phone a couple days earlier, there were these pauses, and we want to share those pauses with you. It's what are we going to do? I respect that Michelle is hustling to try and deliver some other avenues, but I don't want to overpromise that this is a short-term challenge we're going to have. This could actually become long-term. And the real barrier is that we can't contract out for plumbing the way we can electrical inspections. So with anything further, we'll move on to actually a work session presentation. And Councilwoman Monteverde, would you like to introduce the representatives from RECAP?
Yes, we have RECAP tonight. We have the executive director, Charles Quinn, and we have Michelle McCune. as well the Chief Operating Officer, and you'll have to introduce your other colleague.
Senior Housing Developer with me.
Thank you.
We're going to share microphones, I think.
Okay. Do you have enough seats over there?
Oh, you're giving me mechanics. This is going to be fun. Good evening. How are you? My name is Michelle McKeown. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for the Regional Economic Community Action Program. And while Councilwoman Monteverde and Councilwoman Mejia know a lot about RECAP, we felt it was really important to come to the rest of the council and kind of introduce us or reintroduce us to tell you kind of who we are, what we do here, and how long we've been doing it. We are the state-designated anti-poverty agency, which means we have the contract, the CSBG contract, to provide anti-poverty services in many forms throughout the county. And you can see our mission statement up there, and it's to mobilize and coordinate public and private resources, and you can read the rest of it. And in short, we serve the most vulnerable of populations. We serve seniors, veterans, victims of domestic violence, those living with HIV and AIDS, substance abuse, substance use disorder, people who live below the poverty line, people with mental health issues. So we really take a comprehensive approach to the people that we serve. Now, we've had our state designation, and we have been serving in this county since 1965, and we were one of President Johnson's creation against the war, as part of the war on poverty. We came into the city of Newburgh when the city of Newburgh's own community action program was debanded or defunded. They asked, that the state asked us to take over the city of Newburgh, which we happily did. But it wasn't our first entry into Newburgh. We had been in Newburgh for quite some time, providing a plethora of services. And just a couple of reasons we're here tonight is because we own property in the city of Newburgh. I am a very proud resident of the city of Newburgh. And we have apartment buildings where we provide permanent housing for people in the city of Newburgh. And Nate is going to explain in a little while. We received something called an Empire State Supportive Housing Grant. And when I was talking to Councilwoman Monteverde, we were talking about wanting to work with the council and inform the council of what we were going to do so we could do it with the community rather to the community, which we thought was very important and part of our mission in all of the communities that we work in. So we try to be good neighbors. We think we are good neighbors. We have tax, we have buildings that we own in the city that we pay taxes on. So other not-for-profits have opportunities to use their tax-exempt status. We pay taxes on the properties that we own. And we also contributed to the purchasing of the surveillance equipment around the neighborhood that we have houses in. So again, we work really hard to be good neighbors with all of our communities. And the services that we've provided for quite some time in the city of Newburgh are supportive housing, where we provide permanent housing to the populations that I mentioned earlier. We do case management services. So, you know, people who live in poverty don't come in with just, hey, I need a permanent home. They come in with a bunch of other issues, and our case managers are designed and trained to work on all of those issues. We do weatherization, which is we go in and we put foam insulation in your house, and I'm not the weatherization director, so I'm not really sure exactly what we do in terms of weatherization. I know it has to do with making homes more economically viable for the people who live there. So it costs less to pay their utility bill, and that keeps the money in the home so they can spend it on food, they can spend it on medicine, they can spend it on their rent, they can spend it on, I don't know, maybe going to the movies or going out to dinner, right? Because everybody likes to do those things. We also are starting a project at the Mullins apartment to weatherize that entire building, right? The entire building?
Buildings.
Buildings, so the buildings, which we're very proud to be a partner in. We also operate the parole reentry program through the county for the city of Newburgh, and we've done so for many, many years. And we also coordinate the parole reentry task force meeting. So if anybody's ever interested in coming to find out what that task force does and how we do it, and have an opportunity to talk one-on-one with parole, and some of the challenges that the city of Newburgh faces with parole. Please just let us know. We're happy to have you come to those meetings and have the opportunity to speak to parole directly. We do community engagement, which we were very proud of, and we do that in a number of ways. We give out coats, we give out turkeys, we give out food drives. Orange County legislator Kevin Darian Lujan and I spent the day before Thanksgiving dropping off a lot of turkeys to our city residents, and we were very proud to do so. And we really stood in the gap in the center of the city of Newburgh during the tornado response, and over 3 days fed between 2,000 and 3,000 people with County Legislator Lujan, Congressman Maloney's office, and the county itself lent us two grills to do an all-day barbecue on the Friday of that week. So we were very proud of our community engagement response. We also have workforce development projects, and we do that in a number of different ways. And Charlie Quinn, who's my chief executive officer, is going to talk about that in a minute. But I just want to show you what we get every year. And this is the poverty report for the city of Newburgh. And I apologize for the copy, but I took it from a PDF. And the city poverty rate is 34.2%, which is concerning enough. But if you could direct your attention to the box on the bottom, which is the women-headed household poverty number, and that number is frightening on a number of levels. It's women-headed household with children, and it's almost 60%. So one of the projects we've been working on, and one of the projects we've been awarded, is to target that very specific population. So we're going to talk a little bit, Nate is going to talk a little bit about that tonight. And when all it comes down to is we're really talking about the social determinants of health, right? People who live in poverty have greater issues than just living in poverty. And they live in poverty for a variety of reasons. And if we're just looking at their issues of poverty, nothing will ever change, because we're not looking at their mental health issues, their substance use disorder, their domestic violence, and all the other issues that may help them not be able to be economically stable. So our job is to touch on all of those issues, and we want to make sure that we have good partners like Cornerstone and St. Luke's that provide accessible health care. And we partner with our schools to make sure that good educational systems are available. Safe environmental conditions. We have challenges in the city. How can we, as a community partner of the cities, be able to help mitigate those for those who live in poverty? When we're looking at well-designed neighborhoods and availability of healthy foods, Newburgh is classified as a food desert. So how do we get a grocery store into the city of Newburgh that is accessible and walkable to our community? If you have healthy individuals, you have healthy families, you have healthy communities and neighborhoods and a healthy county. And that's really what our goal is, to make sure that we are rising up our entire community by the work that we do and with the partners that we have. So I'm going to turn it over now to Charlie Quinn. He's going to talk about our workforce development programs, in particular our CAFE programs, which exist in the city of Newburgh.
Our CAFE programs are among my favorite, and if any of you say anything, I'll deny that I have favorites to my staff. But I want to back up a second. Michelle went very quickly past weatherization, and it does incredible work of saving energy and making things more affordable for the residents of the building. But another extremely important part of it, especially here in Newburgh, we address a lot of safety issues in buildings, in particular carbon monoxide, and we're inspecting boilers and furnaces, making sure that they're not leaking, making sure that they're safe, and making sure that the buildings that we leave have carbon monoxide detectors. There's a lot that goes into the quality of life and the safety for the residents in that program also. The Fresh Start Cafes, Michelle mentioned that many of our clients don't come to us for just one thing. There are a lot of needs, a lot of complex issues, and we're not there to hand out needs. We're there to get people to a better place in life. Our cafes are job training programs. Our first cafes were funded by Orange County, and our target audience are people who are long-term TANF recipients. Most of them have never held a job. Either later in life circumstances have changed and they have to find a job, or young people who, for substance abuse problems, for bad home lives, have never been able to get a job either. So we start with teaching them the basic skills of life and holding a job, just showing up for work, being properly dressed, how not to get into an argument with your boss. We work on them with sobriety issues. And then we teach them the skills that they need to hold jobs. Our hours are in cafes, so there are kitchen skills, there are nutrition skills, but there's other skills that translate to other jobs at large, customer service skills, delivery skills. So we also work with some entrepreneurship skills. One of the things that we do at our cafe in Newburgh is we set them out with a vending cart outside of the building at 280 Broadway. But before they get there, they plan their business model, what they're going to sell, how to order the materials that they need, develop a marketing plan, and then they go out and do it under the guidance of the staff. And the staff there also act as advocates for the people going through the program. They work on them with their resumes, they work on them with their job interview skills, and they take them to job interviews. One of my favorite stories is Melita, our job developer there, took five men to a job interview. One of the men was primarily Spanish-speaking, and the employer separated him out. The four went to a group interview. He went to his own interview. Everybody was offered jobs. The four English-speaking men had a higher-paying job, and the Spanish-speaking man at a lower-paying, was it a janitorial job?
Mm-hmm.
He was qualified for the other positions, and she went to bat for him and, you know, demanded that he have the same access. And he was brought in and interviewed for the other position, and he did get it. So, you know, we give people skills, we advocate for them. And we bring these skills to, we bring these programs to all of our clients. The first words of our mission were to mobilize and coordinate resources, and we do that. It's not just the people that the county sends to us that can go through this program. We bring in people from our substance use disorder programs and give them an opportunity to learn the skills. We bring in people from the parole reentry program and give them an opportunity to have those skills. In Middletown, we take people from other programs, other agency programs, the Pathstone volunteers over in Middletown, and we make room for them in our cafe. We make sure that everybody has access to all the resources that we have. The cafe is also a cafe. We serve food, breakfast and lunch. It's at 280 Broadway. I encourage you to go there. And in Middletown, we have one cafe which you can't go to. It's housed in Honor, the emergency housing group, and it provides the food for the residents there. But we've also opened our third cafe. It's called Mill Street Cafe. It's in Middletown. This one is not funded by the county. We are raising our own funds through the food that we sell there and the receipts that we generate there. It is our first entrepreneurial venture in our not-for-profit experience, and the food is delicious. If you're in Middletown, please eat there.
I have a question, if it's
absolutely
not too early into this presentation. Where are you located, and what are your hours of operation, and do you have applications on hand?
So our hours of operation are 9 to 5 Monday through Friday. We are at 280 Broadway. That's where our cafe is. We also have a mini conference room there that is available. And our Broadway office is 201 Broadway.
I do want to add that I've actually did take a tour at 280 Broadway. I don't know if you remember me. And I ate at the cafe. Mm-hmm. Also, the Mill Street Cafe does have a social media page.
It does.
Which I did like. So I would encourage everyone else to please like that if you're on social media. I haven't eaten there yet. But I do plan on the next time I'm in Middletown of eating there.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. And just to get an idea of the volume, our Fresh Start Cafe on the Honor Grounds serves 39,000 meals a year to the homeless population that live at Honor. So they do a really, really wonderful job making sure that those who need to be fed are fed with good quality food, and that our trainees are also really, really well-trained when they leave us, which we're very, very proud of.
And those 39,000 meals, the county pays us $40,000 to provide. So we're providing those meals at a little over a dollar each.
One of the, first of all, thank you for the great service that you provide our community. And, I definitely support what you guys do. But one of the concerns is that the city of Newburgh has a reputation of being dumped on, and that whenever we have, whether we're talking about people that are formerly incarcerated, community members that have been, in the prison system for being sex offenders, folks that are homeless, looking for, a place to stay, and so on and so forth. And because you said the county provides you $40,000 for meals and so on, for the 35,000 meals per year, the city and our constituents are looking to figure out a way where not only can we do away with the stigma of being dumped on, but we're trying to do away with the stigma. We're also looking into at the county and state level of how and why Newburgh is always the go-to place for people who are sex offenders, people who are formerly incarcerated in the reentry. There's a population of folk who are homeless in our city, and they're not even from Newburgh, And so these are some of the things that the council is looking into, and we're having ongoing dialogue again with our county and state partners regarding that. And my question is, do you exist in Pine Bush? Do you exist in, Monroe? Do you
Highland Falls? Yeah, so we do not get to choose where people are placed, right? We only provide the services once they're here. That's the kind of role that we play. We have talked to parole, because this concern comes not just in the city of Newburgh, and again, I'm a resident of the city of Newburgh, but in the city of Middletown, in the city of Port Jervis, around the dumping of people. So that's why I encourage you to come to our parole reentry meetings and speak to the parole supervisors who are in the room with us and working on these programs. The way it has always been explained to us is that it is somebody is returned to the place where they came from. Now, I don't have the data to say yay or nay whether or not that is the truth. I can only go by what's been told to me in the past, and I've worn a bunch of different hats in the city for different organizations, and that has been always the line.
So the line is what again?
That parolees in particular are returned to the place where they came from, or have a designated support system upon release.
Now, because I've always heard the opposite, that let's say someone is in a reentry program on parole, and they're not actually going to where they were, like, because they don't want, let's say if you had a person that was incarcerated for 10 years for drugs or whatever, and the parole board won't send that person back to the environment, the sociological environment that put them in that situation, and they're going to go somewhere else. So, these are questions that we've had, we've asked from the county, and the county was here at our last meeting.
Right.
and we brought and raised these questions because, you know, we have concerned citizens. And again, we support RECAP. Mm-hmm. We're very grateful for the services you mm-hmm. provide. It's just that we just kind of want to know from your perspective mm-hmm. How the process works and how and why the dumping appears. I want to use the word appears to happen on our city. And that's no fault of yours.
No. And that. We totally understand that, but we also want to be part of a solution.
A
and I think one of the ways
yeah.
we are is that we provide permanent housing
right.
for those who are homeless.
Right.
And one of the things that we're very proud about the ESHI, and Nate Litwin is our senior housing developer, is our ESHI project is really focusing on those who have that $412 subsidy, right? So if I am, one of our project partners is Project Life. If I'm coming out of Project Life with a $412 subsidy, there's nowhere in the city that I really have an opportunity to live.
Right.
Our ESHI projects addressed very specifically because we did a needs assessment for those people who cannot move out of the transitional housing pieces, and how do we give you permanent housing? And this is the project that we came up with, and I'm going to turn it over to Nate.
Yeah, I'm excited to just be here tonight, first of all, to be in the city of Newburgh, and look forward, I hope, to be able to work with all of you. But essentially what we've gotten an opportunity. Empire State Supportive Housing Initiative, we applied for two different grants. We got the grants we applied for, which was a wonderful challenge. It's a little bit of the carrot and stick, I would say, with this grant, which I think is interesting, because basically the state is saying, we'll give you the dollars if you can build it, because they're essentially giving us the subsidy, and it's a conditional award on getting financing within a year. And there's a chance to reapply if it takes longer, but you know, there's a challenge here in that it's 20 houses, 20 units. We got an award for 20 units in Middletown, 20 units in Newburgh, and we are looking to address critical needs. So Michelle talked about the presence of poverty with female-led households, 60%. So we are doing a project for women identified having a substance abuse disorder or substance use disorder. That would be 10 of the units that are allocated based on the grant. We could always exceed that. Of course, funding needs to be available, but I think we have, in our own minds, you know, want to do as much as we can. And then there's also victims of domestic violence. We've looked in Newburgh to partner with local providers for services. So we have Project Life, Catholic Charities, Community Services, and Legal Services of the Hudson Valley.
Yep.
So we're looking to create relationships. We're looking to grow something. Development is a process of many people. It will take time to you know, start other funding opportunities potentially. But that's what we have here now. I'm happy to introduce it to you and
Thank
start
you.
Talking. So we're also very committed at RECAP to just creating quality housing for folks. So the next slide is has the quote here: "Our home is not just a dwelling place; it should be a place of comfort, shelter, safety, and warmth. It is the main setting for our health throughout our lives." And I don't think anybody would disagree. But we're looking to do housing first. We're looking to stabilize people's lives so that they can be, hopefully, ideally, better community partners. That's where we want to end up. And now we have the funding to essentially subsidize to support folks who are just getting a place to put their feet and their head at night. And that goes to kind of this slide, which is, you know, all the things that can be taken for granted that come from housing: life, well-being, freedom, happiness, warmth, security. That's what we're going towards. That's the goal. And we come with experience. The experience of recap and the many years they've been doing services countywide. They have housing in place on Renwick Street in the city. And also, just to note, one significant project in Middletown. This is 42 units of subsidized housing with a cafe, brand new cafe inside of it. They took quite a large building that was vacant, you could say blighted, historic as well, partnered with a number of people, got tax credits for the project, and it took multiple years, but it was it is completed, it is up and running, the cafe is there, and there's 42 people with a place to go and housing.
Thank you, management services.
And thank you very much, and services, exactly. So we're proud of that history, and now we have an opportunity to do something in Newburgh, and we're looking forward to that.
So in addition to having, we also have a plot of land on Carson that we already own and is buildable. We had a wonderful meeting with Madeline and the Land Bank yesterday to really kind of understand their process. I was presenting upstate at a statewide association, and Nate and I were there. And we went to a presentation by the Syracuse Land Bank, which was very impressive about how they do their work. So I was very excited to come and meet with Madeline. She's wonderful. So we do believe that we have some really good opportunities here, and we want to work with the City Council. Nate mentioned a Housing First model. Housing First is about continued housing stability, regardless of what your issue is. So it doesn't mean that if you have a substance use disorder and you fall off the wagon, if you have a slip, you are evicted from housing. It means we add more case management to you and to make sure that we are being supportive. Our mission and our tagline is not just helping lives, helping people, changing lives. It's really about giving people a hand up, right? The second part of that line is not a hand out. Right, we really, our goal is self-sufficiency for individuals and their family. We partner really well with the city of Newburgh. We are working to put a brand new head start into the city of Port Jervis. We've always worked well with the city of Newburgh. We want to continue that relationship. And you know, Charlie and I have been at the leadership helm of RECAP for 3-ish years. Nate has been here, he hit the ground running in April. And he hasn't slept since, and we're really thankful about that. And so we're looking to really just kind of do a project with you that benefits the most vulnerable of our city partners, our city residents, and do it with the partners that we know do a really good job already, including the city.
So I have a question about that plot of land on Carson. Mm-hmm. How many units are you planning to put there?
So it's a double lot that we found out yesterday.
Yeah.
So we can do 10 units?
Well, we don't know.
Right. Yeah.
There is no plan yet. That's one of the reasons we're here, to get input from the city council, mm-hmm. and you know what you would like.
Mm-hmm. Also, I know that it's not a rendering of Renwick. That's the Middletown.
Mm-hmm. That's, yes. That's,
yes.
Do you have a photo or anything of the Renwick property or?
I. You know what? I did not. I
Renwick,
these.
They have one on Renwick.
Yeah,
we have one on Renwick, correct?
We have apartment buildings on Renwick. We
yeah.
do, yes.
Okay.
I'm sorry. We were just showing that we've developed and built housing before, and this was the this is what the cafe and Mill Street project looked like ahead of time, and then the rendering, and then the other project is when it was mid-construction.
Do
but it's complete.
Do you have the address to the Renwick properties?
I do not, but Charlie
one,
does.
169. 179 and 181.
Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah, I know where those are. Okay.
Yeah, and I can just add for the Renwick properties. Historically, there was quite a renovation that was done. That RECAP led for that. You know. So
okay.
There's been
excellent.
Good work
great.
There.
And you also mentioned a Carson property on.
It's a vacant lot.
We have a vacant lot. We remove garbage from there monthly.
And what is that address?
That is, I believe, 116 Carson.
Yeah.
116?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay.
Yep. And that's what's in our portfolio now, which would likely, given the number 20 of what we got awarded, you know, be one of a scattered site potentially. You know, we kind of got to start with what we have, but we also are starting the conversations with the land bank, with the city, to see what other land is available and what we can do.
Great.
That's part of the process for us.
Any other questions?
No, thank you.
Thank you very much for everything you're doing.
Thank you for having us, and happy holidays to everybody.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Or
I actually left all of our contact information on the last slide, and it's on your desktop, so you should have access to the whole thing. The whole thing.
Great, because I get a lot of calls.
Bring them on over.
Housing. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. So moving on to item number 6, it's a request for temporary sanitation workers, and George is going to give you some background on why that's necessary.
George? So as you know, probably about 2 months ago, we did this once before because of guys being out on workers' comp. We allowed them, I believe it was 12 weeks to stay, and their 12 weeks is up, and I still have 4 people out. One is on a paid suspension, and 3 are on workers' comp and sanitation. And it's just not enough people to do the job. For instance, the Monday and Tuesday after Thanksgiving, on that Monday, they did 80 ton of garbage. On Tuesday, they did 100 ton of garbage without those 4 people in there. What's gonna end up happening is the guys that are there are gonna end up getting hurt because they're doing the work that 4 other guys should be doing as well.
Yep.
George, this is one of the positions that we did budget for, right?
No.
Right, no?
No.
But they were already there.
They're
there, but they're out on workers' comp.
So,
no, I mean the ones you have now. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
All right, so earlier in 2018, we had some staffing issues in the sanitation division. We had some absentee issues that were addressed through disciplinary proceedings. We had some workers' comp issues that left the division short-staffed. There were a series of resolutions that were passed in 2018, amending the 2018 personnel book to allow for temporary hires for short periods of time. The last resolution, I believe, was in September, that was retroactive from 10 weeks from the end of August, which ended, I think, in early November. During the discussion of that last resolution, the comptroller at the time had suggested creating in the 2019 budget a permanent temporary line. A temporary line from which staffing could be replaced on a temporary basis as needed without having to come back to council on these ad hoc basis. And one of the questions that I still don't have an answer to is what the final budget looks like, whether that exists or not, because to assist the sanitation division right now, there would be a resolution. I know we would have to amend the 2018 book to get us through the end of the year, but I have no way of knowing at this point in time what is or is not required going into 2019 to help the sanitation division going forward prospectively.
I believe that was put in there for 2019.
So if there's a temporary line, I'm not sure that
there is a temporary employee.
In 2019 there is, but I need them to start now.
2019.
All right, then I can amend that we go from that we get you to the end of the year. It's only
right.
3 weeks.
Yep.
But I just wanted to be sure that in 2019, once we January 1st came and went, that there's something that would already be in place from you to draw from. Workers on if you need them.
Because as of right now, I don't know when any of these guys are coming back.
No, and I understand that, but again, it's because we're in 2 different budget years while we have the problem, there's more than, you know, there's questions about how to address it.
So,
What is there an estimated timeline of when they are coming back, or it's open-ended?
It's open because I think two of them are knee injuries, one's a back injury. They've been out for well over 3 months already, and some of them haven't even gone for IMEs yet. One of them's got to go for surgery, so this could go on for several months.
And we have it in the budget already for 19, so really what you're asking for is the last 3 months, 3 weeks of the year.
Yeah, and it's not costing anything because they're just filling in the spots for the guys that are already there because they're getting paid workers' comp.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. I can add that for Monday. Yeah.
Right. Okay, thank you. Without further questions, we'll move on to item 7, and that relates to award for bid for sludge disposal to New England Waste Services.
Good evening. This resolution is to award a bid for dewatered sludge to New England Waste Services of Maine, also known as Casella Organics, in the amount of $94.40 per wet ton. This is for a disposal of sludge from the wastewater treatment plant.
Well, how many tons are there? Approximately.
Approximately, I think it was 8,000 per year. I have to look at the numbers again. I don't have those numbers memorized, and I apologize.
And what exactly do they do with the sludge?
So sludge, when it's disposed of, could either be incinerated or landfilled, or sometimes it's applied to farmland as a biosolid. In this case, it's applied to landfill. And it's applied to landfills that Casella, the bid award, actually owns. As time moves on, the disposal costs for sludge and other things continue to increase because of the unavailability of landfill space.
Okay. And this is one of the items that we broke out of the renewal of the wastewater treatment plant operator contract. So just to put it in some context for you, previously, these items were included as the operator's responsibility to dispose of, and it was costing the city a lot more money. And you approved a renewal of the wastewater treatment operator contract, and these items were pulled out for the city to bid out to try and get to find more cost-effective ways of addressing the removal.
To clarify my further answer, it's actually 7,000 wet tons is the estimated quantity per year.
Okay. So that's why these bids are coming to you now. We previously had not bid them out. They'd been part of a larger contract.
Any other questions relating to item 7? Then we'll move on to item number 8, and that's the award of a bid for the grit disposal to TAM Enterprises.
So similarly at the wastewater treatment plant, the plant also produces a grit, and this resolution is to award the bid for grit disposal to TAM Enterprises in the amount of $245 per dry ton of grit.
Any questions related to that?
So I'm going to ask the same thing. What happens to the grit?
It is landfilled as well. Mm-hmm.
Anything else? If not, we'll move on to, thank you, Jason. We'll move on to item number 9.
Thanks, Jason.
And that's an amendment to the 2019 personnel book to add temporary account clerk in the comptroller's office. Charlie? Sorry, I didn't see you over there.
Good evening. Yes, this is to have someone fill in for an employee who is going away on maternity leave. God bless. You know, estimated arrival date of the newborn at the end of the month in January.
So I noticed on the eligible list that there were two that scored high on the, is that what I was looking at? My question is, how are you going to select that person that's going to fill in?
Currently, the Civil Service Commission administrator is canvassing the list to see who is available, and then we will go with the constraints that they typically go in with the grading levels, and we'll bring in candidates and interview them. I will go with whatever her recommended requirements are.
I would like to make a suggestion. Maybe our corporate counsel could have some input as well with that, because she's very knowledgeable.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you.
An additional suggestion is with our new interim city manager coming on board, that he be also included in that interviewing process.
Just for absolutely. The record, the city manager is the appointing authority. So right. The city manager would, whether it's permanent or interim, would have the ultimate determination as to who would be hired for any position, whether it's permanent or temporary.
Right.
And again, when is she leaving?
Expected date is the end of January.
Okay.
So we'd like to get someone in and begin the training process in January.
In January?
Say, January 1, we'd love to have somebody in to be able to train.
Right, so okay. The resolution is to amend the 2019 personnel book. We don't anticipate a change to the 2018 personnel book.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Next up, thank you, is item 10, and that relates to donations. The first up is a 2003 Ford E350 passenger van from the Young and Unique Christian Daycare Center to the Newburgh Recreation Department.
This is a van that we've borrowed from them on several occasions. She's recently gotten a new van and volunteered to donate that to us.
It's good hustle, Mr. Stanton, on that. The next up is, I call this item 10B, resolution authorizing city manager to accept donations in support of the recreation department's Christmas events.
The event will be on December 23rd from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. We'll do the toy drive on the 20th. And those gifts will be handed out along with dinner on the 23rd at the
Wait,
event.
Say that again, Mr. Stan.
The toy drive is on the 20th from 4 to 9 p.m. And those gifts will be given out at the community Christmas event on December 23rd from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m.
And that's sponsored by the city of Newburgh?
Yes, and the Elks Club also.
Now, really quickly, I'm hearing there that there's a possible tree lighting at the rec center?
We're trying to get the outdoor light switch fixed. Oh. Yeah, we will have one.
Because I know there's a city that, on Broadway.
Tree. Ours is not that big. Nothing.
Oh, okay.
No, and they've
okay.
done it in other years.
Oh, you have? Oh, okay.
There's just a tree in front of the building.
Oh, okay. All right, great. Okay.
So with this, let's make sure that we get it out to the public, especially for the toy drive part.
Yep.
Enough time for them to
do you have any donations of toys or anything?
We don't have it in our hand, but the Elks Club is donating $800, and there's a car dealer out, skips my mind right now, but they're donating money also for it.
Okay.
Any further questions? Okay, then we'll move on to item 7, and that relates to city manager accepting a donation of funds from Councilwoman Karen Mejia to complete the purchase of a new electronic device. I don't believe we have the dollar amount yet, but there's a certain dollar value that's available in the council budget.
Which item?
Item C.
10C. There's three donation items under one topic, so trying to consolidate and streamline the agenda. Mm-hmm. So this third item, Councilman Mejia is proposing to replace two electronic devices with one single new one, and she proposes to use money that's budgeted in the 2018 budget but the device may exceed that cost, and she's proposing to donate the difference to the city. The device would be city-owned and continue to be subject to all
right.
of our...
Right, so this is coming on the heels of complete separation of church and state. I don't like to use my personal electronic devices for city business. Right now, it's contained to this iPad, which is dated, and a desktop with Windows 2000. So it's becoming harder and harder to conduct city business. So that's what we're going to – that's the proposal, and I will make up for the difference so that it gets in, combined into one.
Woohoo!
Again.
Maybe not upgrade, but get caught up to the times. Windows 2000 is a bit dated.
It is.
Dated. Yeah. Any additional questions? Comments?
Maybe we should think about doing that for all of us, but that's a discussion down the road.
And, okay. And one of the things that, just to, for transparency purposes, what I've asked the technology department to do is to replace my iPad with a phone because... because of this update, the outdated, the iPad thing is not really comfortable for me. And so right now I've been using my own personal phone for emails and things of such. So anyway, getting things forwarded because I'm just not comfortable with it. So, yeah, I'm looking
to... Is that something that we have in the budget? To do?
My understanding is that there are
he's replacing one device
replacing one device
there's
for
there's no change in subscription or technology cost right. it should be okay.
Yeah so just to let you guys know,
I might jump on that.
Yeah, I'd rather use a phone than this.
Well, Michelle, by Monday will we have the dollar amount to plug in for resolution 10C?
I can give you a range because Nick and I are still discussing which would be the best option for all the different apps.
The resolution reads the difference between the cost and the
budget.
Yeah,
it's just the difference. Yeah, so whatever that is, that's what it's going to be.
Okay, good enough. Moving on then, if there's nothing further on item 10C, is an appointment of Councilwoman Ramona Monteverde to the Newburgh Community Land Bank.
So as all of you know, the Newburgh Community Land Bank was formed and the bylaws provide an ex officio seat for a member of City Council. The initial appointee was Councilman Curly Dillard when he was on the council. After his term ended, the City Council appointed Karen Mejia to that position. That was back in 2014.
What was that?
2014.
What position?
To be the council's designee to the Land Bank Board of Directors.
Yeah.
I've been advised that Councilwoman Mejia would like to relinquish that and resign from that obligation.
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde has expressed an interest in serving, so the resolution is a proposal to appoint Councilwoman Monteverde to the Land Bank Board of Directors.
So if I say woohoo again, that will be, it might get played out, but I'm very, very happy about both of those moves. I think Councilwoman Monteverde will make an excellent job, considering her depth of knowledge about
housing
and other issues. So I'm very excited about this.
Thank you, Councilman Grace.
Yeah, and I just want to say, like, it's been a total roller coaster ride to be part of the sort of founding members of the Newburgh Community Land Bank, not just as the liaison between our board and that board, but also even just as a citizens when the conversations were taking place about the creation of that additional tool that the city has in order to combat distressed properties in our municipality. I am so psyched and rocked. Beyond any excitement to be able to transition out, because this is totally, and I'll make another plug for my whole concept of term limits. Again, the way that you build your bench is by relinquishing and passing on the baton to other individuals so that they also get to experience it. So, rock it out, Ramona. Have so much fun. I think the Land Bank is at a very critical stage to move to the next level of everything that's going to be a phase two, and I am so happy to pass this baby on beyond the freshman to the junior years.
Thank you, and I look forward to being on that board. I will make the commitment as well to pass this torch on. I don't know how long your term you did the you were on the board for. Was it 2 years, a year, 4 years? That seems like a long time. So maybe I can commit to a year or two and then pass it on to another council member. Thank you.
Great.
I also mentioned to Mr. Donat that as the interim city manager, he also occupies a seat on the land bank board. So we'll have two new faces coming on. Moving on to item 12, it relates 12A and B, relate to the ferry parking lot agreements and the corresponding agreement with MTA. Michelle?
All right, so again, trying to streamline the agenda, put related items together. So the city has leased property down adjacent to the waterfront for parking for the ferry commuter since 2004. The lease, the property owner has changed one, two, we're on the third owner since that arrangement has been put into place. The last lease agreement for the property was approved to RBG of Newburgh, and that period occurred from February 1st of 2017 through December 31st of 2018. We are coming up on the expiration. During that time period, the property was transferred to a new owner. That's Newburgh Riverside Realty, LLC. For a number of reasons, we have not been able to negotiate a new lease with Newburgh Riverside Realty, but everybody does recognize that we need to have that parking lot available for the ferry commuters. So we are proposing a six-month extension to that current parking lot lease agreement, during which time it would give the city staff and the new owners and Metro North the ability to negotiate a mutually beneficial lease, new lease agreement. And as part of that lease agreement, the city has received funding from other sources to pay for the rent for that parking lot. It exists at no cost to the city in that regard. So Metro North has been the entity through which the reimbursement for those lease agreements occurs. We also have an arrangement with Metro North for a memorandum of understanding for that payment arrangement. The term of that memorandum of agreement is the same as the lease agreement, so it is coming up for expiration at the end of December of 2018. Metro North has confirmed by email that they are amenable to extending the time period for the same six-month period. So I did revise the memorandum of understanding, and I've sent it to Metro North. I have not gotten an official word back that the document is acceptable in all of its current formation. But because our time is short, I didn't want to be caught in any interim periods. So asking for an approval with the caveat that if there is a substantive revision proposed by Metro North, I would come back to the council in January for an amended approval. But I'd like to be able to make sure that before the documents expires, the city has approved the six-month extensions.
Right. So the ferry service is very important here for the city of Newburgh, and we're definitely looking to expand that service and get that service more often. This lease agreement, though, from what I'm saying, doesn't seem to be mutually beneficial. So I'm hoping that in the 6 months' time that we can get something that's a little bit more.
The ferry service itself is entirely Metro North's responsibility. So while everybody, while the city and the parking lot owners are in agreement that we would like to see more frequent and additional ferry service, that's something that both that we've spoken about in our negotiations, but that does require a commitment from Metro North. And at this point, I can't represent that we have that commitment. On the parking lot lease, the new owners are looking to redevelop those parcels at some point in the future. So they're looking to have some flexibility in where the parking spaces are located, how many parking spaces have to be allocated. Again, the city has always been part of this arrangement as a pass-through entity. We get the benefit of having the ferry service available, but we don't have the funding to actually engage on our own as an independent agency. So, but we'll keep you updated as those negotiations progress, but I think it's important to at least maintain the status quo.
Okay.
Nothing further on 12A and B. We'll move on to item 13, and that's the 2019 liability and municipal property insurance renewal.
So this is the city's annual municipal insurance renewal package. In your packets, you'll find in black and white a handout that describes the structure of the coverage. So we have general liability and public officials and auto liability in the middle block. We have our law enforcement liability on the right-hand side and our municipal property insurance on the left-hand side. The first layer is essentially the city's self-insured retention, either in the form of a deductible or where we pay that first level of coverage. And then we have the insurance companies kick in above those levels of retention. That structure has been the same for many, many years and has not changed dramatically. In this year's proposal, in your packet, in your handout, and I want to go through the relevant pages for you and not get too bogged down in tremendous detail. So the first few pages are an executive summary that just show how the insurance has been marketed basically in the past 15 years or so and where we are today, and you can just have that for history. As we move through, we have not changed. The only additional coverage that we had change was last year we engaged in a cyber liability policy, which we're proposing to renew this year. And then in your handout, it says page 33 at the bottom, but that goes through the pricing structure. And you can see the changes from 2018 to 2019. So the general liability increased by a very small amount. It's a little bit more than $3,000. The property insurance quote actually is reduced by about the same amount, about $3,000. Then there is the equipment, the boiler marine, which is part of the property, that went up, that also came down just slightly. And the liability remained exactly the same. So the overall cost of the insurance package in and of itself is, was last year it was $352,241.99. This year's package is $353,714. Dollars and 28 cents. So it's a very, very nominal increase on the insurance. The last page in your handout is related to the third-party claims administration for our self-insured retention. Last year we had the option of renewing at a lower number of reported claims with an opportunity to rebalance if we exceed the number of claims that came in. The number of claims last year was based on 69 claims. As of November 30th, we received 79 claims for the year 2018. So we're going to have to rebalance for last year. Given the rate of claims over the last couple of years, what we're proposing to do is renew the third-party claims administration contract at a fixed rate. Would be a little bit more than last year, but it would not fluctuate if the number of claims exceeded the amount that it's based on. So it's based on about 82 claims. So if we had, it's based on 88 claims. If we which is about what we're going to end up with this year, so it's right. A pretty good guesstimate. And this way we know exactly what we're paying. We won't have to rebalance or, as they call it, true up later on in the year. And it'll give us predictability about what our costs will be for all of 2019. So the structure and the package is substantially the same. The only thing, coverage that we propose to add, we can now obtain for our two dams downstream liability insurance if there is some kind of unfortunate catastrophic event with either of the two dams. And I know we had some close calls earlier this year. That premium is $1,600. It seems to be a very nominal cost for something that would be a very significant protection. So right. That's the only new item that would be added for this year.
So I have just a couple of questions. I think one is just a statement. As everyone knows, I prefer to, when the city of Newburgh is doing business, I prefer that we do business with businesses that are in the city of Newburgh. But for this company, I'm wondering, how long have we been with them, and do they give us a discount because we've been a loyal customer?
Okay, so we have been with this company for longer than my tenure with the city of Newburgh. One of the things you'll read in the executive summary was in 2010, we went out for a competitive process to look at other brokers. This company, we did a request for qualifications. We pre-qualified. There were only, I think, four responses, and ultimately only three went out to market. The package that we received from Gallagher Bassett was the most competitive by far. The issue is not necessarily with the broker, it's with the competition in the market. So depending on whether the market is competitive or soft, that's going to affect your premium costs, not so much your broker's costs. What I have found, at least in my experience in working with this company, is that they are responsive to our needs. If I have a question, if I need something, if we need a new product, if we need a new service, I always get a call back. I always get attention in person. I've always been responsive. If I need to produce a document, if I need to go back in the history with some of the litigation that we have recently, we will have to research our insurance history. There's some advantages to this. It may be in the next year or two that if we had the right consultant or the right team in the city, we could go out for another competitive look at other brokers. But we just, at least in the last couple of years, we just haven't had the capacity to do this. In terms of getting the quotes for this particular renewal, I usually have a lot of help from the comptroller's office. I have to say that with the resignation, a lot of that work did not get done prior to that time, and we got our renewal application and the information to the broker probably about 60 days later than we normally do, and they still were able to get us a competitive quote, cognizant of our issues with costs, and always seeking to improve. So we got a cyber liability package last year that did not result in a significant increase to our costs, and the dam safety addition that we'll be getting this year at a nominal cost. So they are very, they've always been very responsive to me.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. There's no further questions. We'll move on then to item 14. That relates to the contract renewal with Mesh Realty for management of our city-owned rental property. Ellie, if you could give us some background, that'd be appreciated.
So as many of you know, we take properties in REM once a year, usually. Some of those properties come to us occupied, and the city does not evict people who are willing to pay. We use a property management service to collect those rents and make repairs on those properties if their boiler goes or something like that. And it's been Mesh Realty. So this is for a one-year renewal, same terms. You have a list of the properties that they have now. There are currently 10. I believe three or four of those are looking to buy their properties back, actually.
So we have very few left. They're working with us with very, very little income coming in, and they do a relatively good job.
It's great.
Has it always been Mesh Realty? How long has that been?
Since 2013, it's been Mesh Realty.
And do we put that out to...
Yeah, on the history of that, since 2011, we had been trying to get an outside property manager. We were having a very difficult time with capacity in-house to manage the occupied city-owned properties. The council at the time was very much interested in making sure that that given the economic situation out in at the time, that people who needed to stay in their homes stay in their homes, and so we put out an RFP three times, and the first two times the council at the time declined to actually award a contract to any of the respondees. Finally, the third iteration, we were able to engage Mesh Realty to assist us with this service. And it's been a fairly productive relationship in terms of managing those occupied properties, collecting rent where we can collect rent, making repairs at least on a more regular basis for those properties that would continue to be occupied without taxing Public Works or other city departments who really, we don't always have a handyman that we can send over. Sometimes it requires engaging a plumber. And so it's been a job that the city wasn't really set up to do. And so it's been a fairly productive relationship. If there's a change in policy, procedure, or planning, we'd be happy to discuss doing things differently. But until we have that discussion and we have a plan in place for implementing a new, different, or revised procedure, we recommend that we keep this
relationship. It's basically for another year, and hopefully by... when a year is up, it'll be less properties, correct?
Absolutely. I mean, we will take another round, I assume. It has been less and less every year.
So this ebbs and flows. We have tax liens that we foreclose on every year. Because there's a legal process, it happens in a concentrated period of time. So while right now we have very few properties on the list, in 6 months from now, when redemption ends on the next tax foreclosure proceeding, we may be taking another batch of 10, 15, or 20 properties, some of which may be occupied, right, which need to be canvassed for quality, they need to be canvassed for occupancy, they need to be canvassed for who just didn't pay attention and wants to make a repurchase.
Right, so it's a revolving door.
Right.
Thank you.
And Councilman Grace, it's a local business in Newburgh.
It is. Thank you.
You can throw her off.
They're right important. On Broadway.
Yeah, Rick and Stacy. I know them very well.
Okay.
Well, the question I have concerning Mesh Realty, I know that every year we have a financial statement of what we either receive from them.
That's right. And we need an update.
Yeah, I asked for that today. We haven't gotten the December one, which is obviously the end of the year. So I'll get that as soon as you, and I'll circulate it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ellie. Item 15 is a license agreement for the World Mission Society Church of God. I believe Mayor Harvey, you presented this, and Michelle has written up a license agreement. You want to speak to it, please?
Sure. So I've been meeting with the World Mission Society Church of God on a number of occasions since being sworn in. They were actually one of the first organizations to call my office, and so they have all these wonderful ideas on how they do a lot of volunteer work all over the world, and they see that there's a need to volunteer and mobilize people to the city of Newburgh. And one of the things that they want to address initially is helping the city of Newburgh with our urban blight and our quality of life. So they wanted to get into the city on a Saturday or what have you, on a weekend, one weekend, a day during the weekend, Saturday or Sunday, I think preferably Saturday, and just start cleaning the streets. You know, have they come with 50 or 60 volunteers with bags and garbage and just start cleaning streets, right? And then if there's an opportunity for us to coordinate efforts with DPW, and if there's graffiti on buildings that are abandoned, if there are, you know, and they have, they did an entire video presentation on how urban blight has a direct correlation with crime and criminal activity. So they want to go into a licensing agreement with us. They have a memorandum of understanding on their end. On our end, as on the legal side, we have to have a licensing agreement. They're a church organization outside of our city in New Windsor, in our neighboring town. And I also have spoken to Councilwoman Monteverdi and possibly coordinating efforts for them to work with associations, neighborhood associations, and doing things, you know, so they just want to clean the streets.
Their proposal was very generous, and I did circulate to them a license agreement. It's the one in your packets. I received today, Wednesday afternoon, I received an email.
Bless you.
Which said that they had no edits to the license agreement, but then had a list of questions. And those questions have led to more questions. And I just, at this point, feel that the timeline is too short, and the timing is just not right.
I agree with you.
For this kind of project. So on Wednesday's email asked if it's approved, when do we have to sign, which is not a big deal, but then they asked, well, we would like to have police services. I don't know what the scope of services, I can't say sitting here today right now, what the scope of services would be. And depending on what that is, there may be overtime or other costs associated with it.
Well, we can't have that. I mean, I thought this was all volunteer and they weren't asking for much. So I would ask that. I mean, it's a short notice, and if we could collaborate or work with them for the annual community cleanup, which is taking place in April of 2019, where, you know, it's a coordinated effort. We have other organizations that we're working with, and all the supplies and the dumpsters, and DPW works with us as well. So it would be great, I think, better.
Yeah, to be quite frank, I was surprised to see it in the work session, because we had discussed this in our prior meeting that you didn't have time to do it. There was other issues that were a priority. And I appreciate it. I was surprised to see it, because my last communication with them was that we were going to look to do something in the spring.
And I really tried to get them an agreement. And then, right. So there's a little bit of a disconnect. They read the agreement. I'm not 100% sure they understood the agreement, because the questions that came after it were inconsistent with what was in the agreement. So the request for police services,
okay.
And then there came the request this afternoon for the public works support. So they were expecting the city to provide trash bags, gloves, and a dumpster.
Oh, no.
We don't have the dumpster for sure, and we don't have the funding to obtain it, and certainly not before the proposed date of December 16th.
Well, I think, again, everything's donated for the annual community cleanup in April of 2019, so if they're willing, you know, I'd be happy to work with them.
Yeah, so. That's something that I'm going to circle back with them about, because the dumpster, the police service, and the bags and things of such was totally not what we discussed. So I'll reach back out to them, and as you said, we'll look to see if we can coordinate it with, you know, Earth Day.
I agree with Councilwoman Monteverde. Also, it's embarrassing for an organization outside wanting to come in and make a license agreement to come and clean our city. So, you know, I do agree with collaborating with, you know, what we have in place.
Yeah, no, you know, and, you know, hey, if a neighboring organization wants to help us clean, you know, it's something for the city to consider, and it's something for us to, you know, look at. And if there's an agreement and we can come to a reasonable agreement, hey, if people want to help us clean, I don't have a problem with that.
Just they do it, all like Nike right. says, just do it.
Yeah, they do it all over the world.
Get your own bag.
Well, I mean, they can, look, in the public rights way, if somebody wants to actually, you know, pick up the trash, that's one thing. But one of the requests was to come on actual city-owned property where there, you know, there are things there that we know could potentially cause harm. And so, you know, if these are their high school students, these are teenagers, and, you know, I needed to also insulate the city from potential liabilities and exposures.
Of course.
Yeah. And so, you know, that's why an agreement became more of a priority. You know, it's a wonderful proposal and certainly something that we could look at, but I just think that the way the timing of the request made it very difficult to
right.
finalize something that works for everybody. So they clearly don't have all the materials that they would need, and we're not in a position to supply them, and certainly not in the next 2 weeks, which is when they wanted to have the event.
Yeah, and then when you mention the fact that there are students, then you have to take on the parent permission to do so. I mean,
that's something that would be their responsibility.
Yeah.
Now, my understanding, they were getting college students.
If they were college students, that's fine. Then they would be able to, they would be adults and they would be able to make their own determinations. But again, you know,
it's a nice gesture, but we gotta
work on the timing and the coordination. And I just don't think 2 or 3 weeks was enough time to really make it happen.
Okay.
No.
Thank you.
Okay. So next item up is item number 16, that's a RUPCO, a low-income housing tax credit program application, a resolution from the city in support thereof. Councilwoman Monteverde.
Thank you. We have Emily Hamilton here, and she can come up and just give us a brief description and talk about the project, phase two.
Yes.
Yeah, right here.
Hi, Emily.
Hi. I brought some maps, since I was told not to make a presentation. But these are graphs, but it shows.
You can just pass them down, Emily.
From the projects.
I think
we can pass them.
We'll pass them.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But our first phase. Hello, everyone. My name is Emily Hamilton. For those of you that don't know me, I am the real estate development project manager for RUPCO. I'm a little too close to the microphone, apparently. So as many of you know, we just had a ribbon cutting for East End Apartments, and that was just completely occupied. And the ribbon cutting was on September 25th. That's 45 units of mixed income housing from 30% AMI to 80% AMI. There's also seven supportive housing units in that project. And so now we are applying for 61 additional units of housing with the state of New York, with New York State Homes and Community Renewal. The other part of that project, it'll also be a mixed income project with some supportive housing as well. The other part of that project is we will be acquiring most likely the First United Methodist Church and 257 Liberty Street. Which basically means in the future we would have control of that city block. And we would be working on that project along with Black Vanilla Community Foundation. The properties that we are acquiring for the residential portion are Newburgh Community Land Bank properties. There's 22 of them. Right now, actually, there's 20, and we're subdividing, in the process of subdividing 116 Lander into 114 and 118 Lander Street. So there's going to be, if awarded funding in June, May or June, and we would hopefully start construction by September or October of 2019, and there would be 10 additional buildings that would be rehabbed in the Land Bank neighborhood north of Broadway, and then we'd be constructing 12 new buildings.
So I think Councilmember Monteverdi was helping you with this situation. There was some data that you had needed. What did that?
Yeah, so as part of the application to the state, we were just doing some research into how the assessed values have changed with our phase one properties with East End Apartments, and then projecting into the future with this second phase, what we're calling Newburgh Progress. And so we've asked the Benjamin Center to help us with that study, and they're looking for a shapefile, a GIS shapefile from the assessor's office. So that's and what that was about.
Right. So the data that they gather from this study, will it be accessible to the city as well?
Yes.
Or is it just?
Yes.
Also, I've been in communication with the Black Vanilla Community Foundation pretty much directly, and our legal department, because we still have some challenges with the Liberty Street property near the Audrey Carey Park.
Right.
We have some challenges. It's currently owned by a third party, but we have been working to develop some strategies see if there's a beneficial way for that property to become part of this project in an efficient way. And the last time that I spoke to internally, we think we might have found a path.
Okay.
So we're working on that one.
Okay.
We are also working directly with the owners of the property.
Right, and part of we're trying to find a beneficial way to facilitate a transfer. That transfer ultimately, I'm sure that the lawyers involved on the other side will want the city to approve in some shape or form. The city has a little bit of leverage, and we're trying to work on that. So
good. Okay.
Great. Yep. Can I just say, this is, when I look at things like this, when we talk about projects like this, it's like, it's a good way to end the year of public service, because this is why I ran. You know, this is what keeps a lot of the homeowners in our city still here, because we're turning on lights. It's not like we're looking at the tunnel and seeing the light at the end of the tunnel. It's like we're turning lights on in the tunnel. And that is super exciting. I mean, when I look at this and like all of the different, you know, sort of, we're not doing scattered, we're doing concentrated. It's amazing. And I love the fact that, you know, at the very core, we're having conversations about doing development without displacement, which is at the core value of my beliefs. And I love the fact that we're having mixed income attached with supportive housing into this project, as it was with phase one. So love the Newburgh Progress. I think, thank you. You know, I just want to say thank you, because you're leaving me really pumped for 2019.
Yeah.
And best of luck with the application and my full support.
Thank you.
Yeah. I want to echo those sentiments, because if not all of us, I believe all of us were at the ribbon cutting, as you alluded to, in September, and it was amazing, and those apartments are amazing, and it really changes
the block, like the work that we've seen you guys do, REBCO, and continue to do, it changes the neighborhood. I mean, Johnson Street, 39 Johnson Street, will never be the same
again.
It's come back, actually. Yeah.
It's great.
So, yeah, this, yeah, just great.
Yeah, and then, you know, because I gotta do my PSA. My PSA around this is, if we've learned nothing in 2018 around the community conversations about what development looks like in the city, I just want people to know that when we're talking about 40% area median income, when we're talking about 60% area median income, that is market rate, okay? So I want to flip the switch on that, because it is not subsidized. It is market rate housing that is getting built.
Right. Quick question, Emily. On phase two, I don't know if you have figured out, you're doing more 2 and 3 bedroom.
Yeah, so right now it's out of the 61 total units, there'll be 32 three bedrooms.
Okay, great. Because I think there's a greater need for more bedrooms.
Yes, we determined that by speaking with Safe Harbors, who's managing the first phase. From the applications that they've received, the largest or the longest waiting list is for 3 bedrooms.
Now, when you say City of Newburgh landmarks, what do you mean by that on this map?
So basically, we're trying to, this is part of our application.
Oh, okay.
To the state of New York, to New York State Homes and Community Renewal. It's actually a requirement. This is called the Neighborhood Plan. And this highlights the resources that are within a half mile of the project area.
Okay.
So things like the library.
School district.
Right.
Okay. Also, I know you needed a letter of support.
Yes.
I believe that got done.
Did it?
Yes. Oh, you didn't pick it up yet?
No.
Okay. Right. Well, I'll follow through upon that.
Okay.
Because yeah, Eliana, I believe, got it done for
us. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, it was completed.
Oh, it was. I thought so. All right, yeah. Thank you, Michael. Yeah.
All right.
So next item up is item 7.
Thanks.
Pardon?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your patience. The next up is item 17. That's a local law relating to sewer use rents.
So just a quick recap. The city had done a rate forecasting study to fund the long-term control plan related to our sewer projects. That rate study recommended progressive increases in the sewer rates over a period of time. Last year, the sewer rates were raised 4% from 100% of the customer's annual water bill to 104%. In the 2019 budget, there's another 4% increase that has been approved, so that would change the sewer rate from 104% of the annual water bill to 108%. This local law would harmonize the code with the budget. Public hearing was convened and completed on November 26th, and now the local law is ready for a vote on Monday.
Next up, then, is item 18 related to residency requirements, section 312.
So this is we went through this item with the notification of the reminder that we would be holding a public hearing on Monday night. I don't think we need to reiterate the whole thing.
No.
It's here as an agenda item because there was a sense of urgency that it be available for a vote as soon as possible. At the closure of the public hearing on Monday night, when you get to the city manager's report, you would be able to vote on it on Monday night if you so chose.
Are we still going to do that even though there's...
You're going to hold your public hearing, which is a prerequisite. Once the public hearing is convened and completed, the convention of the council in the past is to vote at a future meeting, but because of the urgency with the plumbing inspector position, there was a request that if the council would vote at its earliest opportunity, if they were so inclined, which would be Monday night, we put it on. That's why it's on the agenda twice.
Okay. But given the light of New York State law and given our current situation, I still think it's appropriate that we have it and then vote on it so that it
opens us up when the next opportunity.
If it's approved, then we would be able to reissue the announcement with a slightly different flexibility on recruitment.
Okay.
Okay, moving on to item 19. It's a discussion item relating to the naming of the skateboard park for Roxy Royal. Councilwoman Rayford.
Okay, thank you. We do have in our folders the proposal, and I will let you read it, Mother Royal, at a, I guess tonight I'll let you read it. But it's stating that the skateboard park will be named after you. Mm-hmm. We are going to take a vote, hopefully Monday.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. I know that there was a person, I'm not going to say the name, that did bring up other people who was supposed to be involved, but that was after the fact that she brought it to our attention and
right. And so,
you know, right. Went forward.
So in respect and out of honor for Ms. Roxy Royal, I believe that she does want to speak for a few minutes. Yes? No? And we've had a conversation about this when she was doing the election for the NAACP. We do have a new NAACP president, Mr. Cesar Raynor. So I'm very happy about that. But yeah, but if Mrs. Royal would like to say a few words.
Thank you very much. We do have the park here, and we have, and it's up and going. And I thank you for considering me. But to have the park named in honor of me would be something really, you know, it would be great. I would be grateful for. But that was not my object in the beginning. And I'm just thankful that we do have a skateboard park here in the city of Newburgh for our young people and the youth of our city to enjoy. That was the purpose in the beginning. I wasn't looking for a medal or recognition, because I thank God that he gave me that idea and through him, because I had spent a lot of time with myself thinking of what we could do to help, you know, the youth. And I was here at the last meeting where there was a discussion about whether it should be one person or should be a group. But if we look back in time, there's always one person that's named in lead. Everything started with an idea. And somebody brought that idea. But that one person never brought that idea into fruition. It had to be a group. He had to have help from somebody else. So it was my idea. I brought the idea to the group. The group, accepted it, and everybody went to work to make the skateboard park happen. It took years, as all of us sitting here know, for that skateboard park to come about.
Absolutely.
And thank God, at that time we had Mayor Kennedy with us.
Yep.
But every time we had a problem or something come up that extended the time of getting that park, she always would say to me, Roxy, you're going to get your park. We're going to do it. And by the grace of God, we did. If my name is put on that park, I will be grateful. If it is not, I will still be grateful. And if you do it with everybody that was on the committee that worked with it, we will be grateful. Mm-hmm. So I just thank you for considering me. And, you know, if it gets done, I will be happy. If it doesn't get done in money, I'll still be happy.
It's going to get done.
Because we you know, we'll have the park. Mm-hmm. And I've heard people talking about it. People have come to me and have said to me how great what a great thing they think it is. not people just in the city of Newburgh, but in the surrounding areas. One lady was talking to me that lives in New Windsor. She brings her children here to play in the state park, in the skateboard park.
Okay.
So, as I said before, if I'm considered, thank you. If I'm still, I'm not considered, thank you anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm not looking for, you know, to be put on a pedestal.
So I have one question. Once this is passed, you have to pick a date so that we can have this done.
I'd like to actually hear from the committee, and I also just want to point out that I thought that there was a moratorium on naming parks and streets. So am I wrong in thinking that? Or right, but there is recently a moratorium on it, so I just want to make sure we're following procedure. And if there was a committee that worked on this, I would like to hear from the committee as well.
But didn't you hear from him last week?
No.
What committee? Am I right?
Yeah, she did. One person did.
She was on the committee?
Barbara Smith. Came to the committee.
Correct. And the kids, I'd like to hear from the youth that worked on it as well.
The man that worked on it, I spoke with his mother whenever the skateboard park
was
open. And he was in England. He's still going on with his, and it wasn't just him. Right. We used to have groups of youth in the city come to city council meeting pleading for that skateboard park.
Yeah, no, I remember that. But again, Tenebit, a lot of people worked on this park and making sure that this park happened. So I think it's only fair that, you know, we name it after a group of people. But to name it after one person, I'm not in agreement with that. Nothing personal.
Well, that's why we have to take a vote. But the thing is this. If you read what's drafted, it says a lot about Mother Roa here. And at the ribbon cutting, she was one of the persons that we all acknowledged, and she had words. Even with the youth, they said so much about Mother Roa, along with Ellen Philo, Deirdre Glenn, and the council. We all had something to say in honor and thankfulness to her idea. So
right, I was there, I remember. And I think we talked about everybody that worked on the park, so it wasn't just one person.
Yeah, I'm just saying, I mean, what else can be said? You know, it was said at the park, at the ribbon cutter. So I don't know, for the rest of the council, can we just have this to come to a vote? Give her the flowers while she yet lives.
I will be happy. I will be pleased. If I don't, I will still be pleased, because it's not about Roxy Royal. It's about having the skateboard park
for
the youth of the city of Newburgh to have something to do. We've had too many of our youth, because of not having anything to do in the streets. They were skated. They're using their skateboards in up and down Broadway,
right?
Running between the trucks, grabbing the backs of trucks, having the trucks pull them along. They all over the city, up and down the streets. They were
right. Yeah.
Using their
skateboards. I remember why we made sure that park happened. But why are we in such a rush to name it after one person? I don't understand.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I think
and it's not only that. And I'm not looking for a lot of praise, but the job that you have now, I was one of the people that supported the idea of the hotel being renovated, because there was a lot of opposition to it.
What are we talking about now? What now?
Whenever they made the proposal to do the hotel.
What does it have to do with the park? I'm sorry.
No, it doesn't have to do anything with the park. But it just goes back to, you know, that a lot of these things that are coming up, I don't know, you know.
No, but she's saying I supported that
it's
project.
It's been down so through the years that this is the first time it has come up that you had to do, have this bigger thing over naming somebody for.
You know, this whole thing of naming stuff, it's really interesting just from a cultural perspective. So my two cents around this is, one of the things that I thought was exciting about how this park got built, one, it took less time than Tyrone Crab Park, which was like a major thing for our city, because we didn't have to wait 40 years for the things to get built. So that was amazing. The other thing that I was really energized about it was that for the first time we had a multi-generational group come together. And so for me, ideally, if we were keeping true to the symbol of the naming and the effort that went beyond it, I mean, Wyatt should get represented in this. I mean, you know, a joint, if we're gonna name it, if there's enough support to name something, it should be a joint support that shows the difference, the different generations that participated in it. If it's just one single, you know, last name that's attached to it, I think it negates the history that went into that park, because it was driven with the youth coming to the forefront and saying, we want this, and then the older generation saying, we're gonna support you in getting it. So as the resolution stands now, Ms. Royal, you know, I completely respect you. I have the utmost respect. You have always, you know, shown up for the community. But in this instance, like this, like my wish would be that it was a either multi last name naming and the cross generations, because I think that that represents what it took to build this park.
Well,
I'm
saying that we, whether it get named for me or whatever, I'm thankful that God has allowed that part to be
right. And
thank you.
I want to say the same thing, Roxy. I appreciate everything you've done over the years. You've been everywhere. What I would suggest is, because I don't want to, Michelle didn't answer if we put a moratorium, because we did at one time. But why don't we go to all the people that were involved in the park and let them make the decision? Because I think they'd probably decide, most of them, that they would want it named after Roxy, but let them make the decision. All the people that worked on the park together, Wyatt Stevens, Barbara, everybody.
It's my recommendation.
Because if we're not gonna get a consensus here, then if we go to them and they say yes, then we have our consensus. I think that's a fair way to do it.
That's a fair way to do it.
So just
because I think they'll agree with it, but I don't think we're gonna get the votes here, so I think. You're right, we have the park, and it's a nice thing to say. I wish more of them wore helmets, but that's just me.
How would you get those youth back here? We got to go through Wyatt and who else?
You had Treasure. You had Treasure. I forget, Treasure Jackson.
Instagram.
You had Wyatt Stevens. You had.
Why don't we have him come on Monday and speak during the public?
I don't know if he's here. Wyatt was in England working the last time I spoke to his mother.
Darius he's my neighbor. I forget Darius's last name. But I knew a few of those students. So it was Wyatt Stevens, Treasure Jackson, Darius. There was another. What's that? Darius Perez, he's my neighbor. And then there was another Latino young man that was really good friends with Darius. Duncan, yeah. So those are the four guys I know personally. Yeah, and the other thing.
You know what you're not looking at? Somebody had to have an idea. There had to be an idea. You had to have a starting point.
Right.
And then after it got started, then those that made it happen, it's fine.
Right.
But everything starts with an idea.
And it was your idea. Thank you, Marvin.
And somebody had to come forth with an idea.
Okay. I agree with the notion that it would be nice to hear from the young people and get their perspective to weigh in on this. Also, because I remember myself, Councilwoman Rayford, Councilwoman Mejia, we were all on the city council when that resolution was passed for the funding, and I remember it being years and years, because I remember Councilwoman Cindy Holmes had been pushing and pushing to try to make this happen, and it couldn't, for whatever reason, it just, we couldn't come up with the funding, it couldn't happen, and then I was on that council, on the council when it happened. It happened, I think, 2016. Mm-hmm. And shortly after Councilwoman Rayford and I got sworn in, and we were a united council with Mayor Kennedy, and we made sure that money came. It was like $1.1 million from, I think it was some funding from Larkin. We had some, mm-hmm. Yeah, it was some.
$350,000.
Yeah, then was some CDBG money funding as well.
Larkin's name on it.
So, yeah, I think we should hear if we can, I don't know if we can get the young people here for Monday.
But also, I think what the council, what we need to, because when the street naming is always, there's always a negative connotation to it as well, you know, a comment. We need to find out, because as it was stated before, we don't want street naming to cease. You know what I mean? And it's really not street naming, it's just acknowledging people, because if it was really street naming, it would go into DOT's documents, which will then go to our maps, our geography, whatever plans, but it doesn't go that far. It goes right there on the corner, and that's it. So, you know, I know that some people on the council have a hard time I guess voting or being involved in street naming or don't even want it. So I think the council.
I don't have a hard time with it.
Ramona, you're always saying something.
No, I don't.
Negative. So
I don't understand why there's a rush to name streets. I don't even.
It's
think
not
we
a rush.
It's
not a rush, because it's been in discussion for a few months. Maybe about 4 or 5 months.
You know, the other day I did the calculation, and roughly we have 30,000 people that we expect to be in the city. It would take us 82 years if we just started recognizing everyone. Yeah. And I'm not being flippant about it. You know, I want to just recognize that, you know, there is a process for this. And mi gente Latina, despiértense, because, you know, like, if we are representing the city as a totality, then we need to have guidelines that accurately represent
I agree.
That.
Thank you.
So
we should have guidelines, and people should be acknowledged.
Yeah,
same streets,
you know. And then when you say 82 years,
what I don't want is like a race. I mean, we're like, we're debating this. It should be something positive, you know. We always get into these, like,
let's not use it for
votes. Know. But anyways, I'm just putting that out there. You know, like, there's nothing more than time in this world. And by my calculations, 82 years, and we'd be done.
Can we move forward?
I was
yes,
about to say
please.
It. I think it's.
Thank you for that. And I feel that, yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have to make a decision. Are we going to table this, try to get everybody here on Monday to speak, or is it just going to go to a vote on Monday? We have to make a decision before we move on.
Well, it on the agenda, it said it was a discussion item. It's not on the agenda for a vote for Monday.
Right. Right.
Oh, okay.
It's not,
I'm sorry.
But one of
yes,
our purposes was to see if council wants it to be on for a vote. Or if you want to have more time to bring the group to speak,
yeah,
perhaps at the
end of the session. I want to just say three things. All right. One, there was a resolution 2 years ago. It was a moratorium on street naming, okay?
Not park naming.
Okay. So it was somewhat limited in scope. I've repeated this a few dozen times now. There should be a structure, a committee, to establish a structure for honoraria in general, whether it's naming a street, whether it's naming a building,
right.
Whatever.
Right.
There are other cities who do this. They have structures. I have sent to the council a couple of different times a report that the City of New Orleans Planning Commission put together. It's a really good overview. I would encourage everybody to take a look at it. And again, you know, this would be a committee to propose policies, procedures, and standards. So it would require some volunteers from the community to actually get together and do this. And that's another sore spot. So at this point, to me, it doesn't sound like there are four affirmative votes out there for this particular resolution. And rather than engage in setting something up to fail, my recommendation would be not to move it forward until there's either something that you all can agree on, or there's some movement along the spectrum there.
What I'd like to look at putting together that committee, hopefully for the first of the year, and follow those New Orleans guidelines perhaps, and because this is probably going to become a bigger issue as we move along, I imagine. So,
but on this one particular issue, I really think in this case that we should hear from the people on the committee and see if they want to name it after Roxy. If they say okay and they all worked with her, why not? I just, you know, and then we could put this committee together after the first of the year. But I think we should let the committee that worked on the skateboard park make a decision before we throw this out. That's just my opinion. Because I would vote for it if the committee said
that. Right, but I think it's going to be a little difficult to get a consensus of a committee between that doesn't know that they have to give a consensus between now and Monday night.
Right. It's a discussion item. It's not a resolution.
Right. It's a discussion item so it's not on the agenda. I wasn't looking at it.
We can move on.
Okay. Number 19, also by Councilwoman Rayford, an African-American Black Pride Parade and Festival resolution.
Okay. Well, this is really going to flip your wigs. Put in a black parade together with a festival, and I was talking with corporate council in having this parade or this day named after Sadie Talley. I will make sure that everybody on the council, including the mayor, have her bio. I do have that ready and available. Through email, ready to send to you. So this will take place June 1st. It's on a Saturday. And our wishes is to have a parade starting from Richmond Ave, going down West Street, down Broadway. It used to go down South Street, but I will give you the specifics. But and then to have the festival inside Downing Park. So.
Anything further?
No, just the only thing that I would say is that I think that, you know, this is, aside, you know, obviously the naming, you know, it's a parade and it should have a name and all that, but the importance of people having pride, and especially in the era that we're in, I love the whole concept of, you know, the black pride because black lives matter. So if this is an attachment to that, I am completely and totally all for it.
Is there going to be a committee put together to organize it?
Oh, this is it's taken care of, yeah.
Oh, okay, and so it's going to be sponsored by the City of Newburgh?
By the city, yep. It's just back. It was in place years and years ago, but it's back now, so.
Any other comments?
Am I putting this on, or am I waiting for more information?
No, you put it now.
Well, I think we need to know who the committee is. Has the city voted to sponsor it? Because that means there's...
That's what this is for.
And where's the funding coming from? And, you know, certain questions. I'm not against it at all because we had spoken about this before. But I'm a planning person. And when you plan something, you want to know who your committee is, where the funding's coming from. Those would be the two main things I would be interested in knowing. Because we also have to have police overtime, because they have to, you know, cordon off the streets just like they do for the Memorial Day Parade. So it's basically the same route the Memorial Day Parade is taking. So
if you can recall, when we did the budget hearings and we did the parades, that was included. And then it was last month when we was reassured that it was a part of the parades that we will be having. But this one now is up for vote.
So there is a budget for it?
We were at the budget hearing and they said they would submit it and everything is fine.
Mr. Duffy, is there a budget for this?
I don't know specifically on that budget line item, but
there was zero when I looked at it. There was zero. International had money.
Look in the book now.
Right.
For Monday.
Please confirm that.
Yeah.
It was.
There's no funding.
See, and that's what the thing, when you're on the council, you got to be very, very careful what you say. Make sure it's documented. Because I've been saying this for months, months and months about this parade, bringing it back. And now all of a sudden, you know, things are different. But, yeah, I'm ready to vote. I want to see how this goes along with the other parades.
It's a good thing we record our meetings, is all I got to say.
Yes, we do.
Okay, then we'll move on to item 21, and that's relating to the cancellation of the second December council work session and council meeting.
I don't know. With all this here, it looks like we might have to have those meetings.
What I would say is there hasn't been a lot of energy to have a second meeting in December over the last couple of years. The charter requires that if you're going to change or cancel a meeting, that you do it by resolution one meeting in advance. I will point out that if you do not wish to completely cancel the work session, the regular meeting would normally be held, it would fall on December 24th. And I don't believe that anybody...
I won't be here.
Right. I don't believe that anybody really would like to hold, and it would probably be inappropriate to hold a meeting on December 24th. So...
I would.
Okay. You'd be the minority. I'd be available, but that's a whole different ball game.
JK.
You know, if you want, you could hold a short work session and schedule your regular meeting for December 20th. And if we had any items, we could do it all on December 20th.
No. If we're not going to have a meeting, I don't want to have a work session.
No. What I'm saying is if you think you're going to need a meeting, you would have to change the date from December 24th to some other date. You could conceivably, if you had to, the agenda would be rather short. You could convene a short work session and then reschedule your regular meeting from the 24th back to the 20th and get it all done in one night if it was something you were interested in doing.
So I have two comments. My first comment is usually when it's a break, I do take a break. I try to get away from I love Newburgh, but I do get away from Newburgh. Yeah. But then my second comment is I think that we knew last year that December 24th was coming. And so why was it scheduled that way?
Because the way the charter reads our council meetings are held on the second and fourth Monday of each month, with the exception of June, July, and August when there's only one meeting, meetings where those Mondays are holidays, the meeting is then had scheduled for the next business day. So we don't move the meetings. The meetings are kind of set. And if they happen to fall on a day that is not appropriate or not convenient, then it's incumbent upon the council to change them. That's why we bring these things up for discussion. Okay. So even if December 24th was not an appropriate day, the next day would be December 25th, which would not be an appropriate day either. Mm-hmm. So here, you kind of have an issue either way.
Right. So in terms of, you know, just sort of segueing into the need for an additional December meeting, I think the only thing that I would be interested in discussing at an additional December meeting is the current situation of our paving, especially in Ward 1. So I'm going to use this as the segue to just get a quick update from Mr. Morris on where we stand on that. And it will probably have to get repeated again on Monday, but at least for the folks who are tuning in to this work session, they can get some peace of mind about the status of things.
Yeah, can't we caucus?
If we want to meet in December, can't we just call a caucus meeting for us to meet? I thought we could
no,
do that.
No, because you can't vote in a caucus meeting.
Right.
But we could discuss things.
No, you really, no, that's, no, you really, if you're going to have a meeting, if four or more of you are going to get together for the purposes of discussing the public business under the open meetings law, it's a meeting, and it needs to be noticed to the public and the media under the open meetings law. Where a caucus comes in is if you wanted to have an executive session, or you wanted to have a caucus of all the board members who were of the same political party, then that's an executive session item. But if you're going to, I would strongly caution you not to meet all together, or four of you, for the purposes of discussing the public business without noticing a meeting. I would be strongly careful about that.
So drinks at my house are off now, because.
Since when?
Yeah.
About,
right.
Sorry, Mr. Morris.
Sure. So we had, engineering had a meeting with the contractor for the sewer separation project today, and they outlined their anticipated paving schedule as starting as early as tomorrow with the prep work and continuing work through the weekend into next week in an effort to pave the streets through that sewer construction corridor. So we will be posting notifications on Facebook and the city's website related to the ongoing work to try and make the residents in that area aware of the both the ongoing work through the weekend and the anticipated paving schedule.
Great.
Thank you.
Okay, then we'll move on to item 22. George, can you talk to us about the increase in fees for tipping?
Yes. Are we still cow tipping?
Are we what?
Just kidding.
What was he saying?
Are we still cow tipping?
Back in November 8th, I sent you all an email letting you know that Orange County raised the tipping fees from $84 a ton to $104 a ton, which is going to affect my budget by about $200,000.
How much?
About $200,000. So if you multiply that $19 a ton by 9,500, 10,000 ton a year that we pick up, you'd almost $200,000. I was also made aware last week that in the budget that 2017 had a $180,000 deficit. So we're looking at almost $500,000 we got to find somewheres in the sanitation budget line.
How much?
Almost $500,000 between the deficit and the increase in the tipping fees.
So I don't have that amount of money in my account. What I do want to tell the public is two things. Please reduce the amount of waste that you have, and also on your trash cans, if you could put the lid on top of the trash cans, especially if it's raining, that way it reduces the amount of water, because they're going by the weight, and then we're paying to throw away rainwater.
Right. Being that you're talking about that, one thing that I'm going to work with Charles Duffy on is for the next work session in January is to come up with maybe some figures and some ideas of what we can do for recycling.
Yep.
And possibly getting somebody out to start writing violations on recycling, on sanitation not being out, and maybe deliver a little revenue on this. So we just want to make you aware of it and bring it up to speed in the first
We have to get
session.
Back to enforcing the recycling.
Well,
I think
we put that grant in because
yeah,
that's what I've been on since January. Because we had the recycling, George and I discussed
also,
it when it was 10 years ago, and it was really enforced.
Yes.
It was enforced then. And I recycle, but like I've said before, my recycling truck stops at my house and then goes down the street and around the corner because nobody else is doing it. And that would limit our tonnage if everybody recycled, because it's nice to say, you know, put lids on your garbage pail to do away with the water, but if we did the proper thing with our garbage like other municipalities do, and it's enforced,
well,
that's the thing, we're not enforcing it.
Also, if we really looked at other municipalities that are doing have a substantial recycling program, not only will it be environmentally responsible, but it will also help us generate revenue, because certain municipalities have recycling programs where the city gets paid revenue for the recycling.
That all depends on what the market is. If there's no market for it,
right,
then we got to pay them. But it's still, with paying, it's $65 a ton, not $104 a ton. So
either
it's
a cost saving.
It's cost savings.
Also, I talked to Mrs. Anderson, and Joe, this may be between you and Michael an opportunity to circle back. There's a woman, Mrs. Anderson, who I actually went to high school with years ago. She works in Orange County, in the executive Orange County with Steve Newhouse and Harry Poor, and she has a substantial amount of funding, grant funding, for what they call shared services. And every so often they have a shared services meeting in Orange County, and one of my recommendations was, because I'm always looking for how can we get bulk garbage pickup back in our city on a monthly basis, because again, as we all know, that was a service that was taken away from us years ago. It used to be the third Wednesday of the month. Now, if we can't get the county to help us with those with the bulk garbage pickup costs, maybe we can get them to help us with our regular garbage costs, where they're coming once a month to help with some of the garbage and some of the tipping fees or whatever, because there's a significant amount of funding. I'm talking millions of dollars for the county to decide, okay, there are these shared services, and shared services could be sanitation, and to help all the municipalities in Orange County with those sanitation fees.
I'm in favor of shared services also. I know for the district, we've taken advantage, for the school district, we've taken advantage of them. So I am in favor. I think that we do need to look carefully at them, though, to make sure it's a win-win, because sometimes the shared service is a shared service, but it's further out. But I am in favor of looking at those shared services as well.
Because those are funds that we haven't benefited from at all in the 2018 fiscal year. We have not tapped into their shared services fund for the county at all.
Right.
And that's because of lack of due diligence in following up. Because the money's there, the people are there, the committee at the county is there. We just got to figure out, hey,
what's stopping us from doing it?
Follow through with communication, you know? I mentioned because when I was at the New York Conference of Mayors with you, Ramona, and Mr. Jonathan, that I got a phone call one of the mornings before the seminar from Mrs. Anderson, and she introduced herself, and she said, hey, here are millions of dollars that the county has. We're trying to coordinate efforts between municipalities and figure out what are some of the common needs between all the municipalities in Orange County, Middletown, Port Jervis, Goshen. And one of those things is we got rising costs in sanitation. If there are shared services and we all agree and say, hey, we need $2 million throughout the county for the county to pick up, you know, sanitation once a month or twice a month to help us with those rising tipping fees and costs.
Maybe one of that could be, because a lot of the municipalities around here do not do bulk pickup anymore because of the cost.
Right.
So maybe it could be something working with other municipalities to do a bulk pickup 2, 3, 4 times a year.
Right, right. And that we'll take that instead of, you know, once or twice a year. If they're if we're doing it once in October and then on Earth Day in April, and then the county's picking it up, you know, that's going to cut down on the illegal dumping. That's also going to cut down on our expense, our sanitation cost. So something
do it,
to really
do it every quarter, and it's coordinated where all the municipalities do it at the same time.
Exactly. Yeah.
George, what happened to the grant? I'm looking up and down Millennium Strategies here, and we all had conversations, and I don't see that it got put in. October 31st, the one for the recycling truck and the...
Yeah, when I talked to Dave about that, he said that, if I'm not mistaken, that's a year or two down the road.
No, it was supposed to be, the application was supposed to go in on October 31st.
I believe he did put it in.
Yeah,
it's not here anywhere.
It's not in there. No?
It's not here.
I have to find out from Dave.
This is an updated one that was in our package.
So this is all really nice, but we have an immediate problem.
What's that?
In the sanitation fund. That needs to be addressed.
But recycling will remedy.
Yeah, no, we're talking about things that could, might, may happen 6, 12, 13 months from now. So,
well, if it was enforced for the last 10 years by the city of Newburgh,
you can't go back. You can't go back.
We can't, but we have to go forward, Michelle.
Right, and
I want to know where that grant is, because I see that we're paying these people $3,500 a month, and they've put in...
Agreed.
Nothing.
Agreed.
We can't count the SAFER grant. And I don't see that grant here that we all spent time on in
agreed.
It was due October 31st, which was a $2 million grant, enough for a recycling truck to hire people for codes.
Agreed. But here's the issue.
Where is it?
Agreed. It should have been in there. It's not in there. There's a problem, and we need to address Millennium. But the real critical issue here for the sanitation fund is twofold, one of which hasn't even been mentioned. So from what I understand, okay, the 2019 budget was adopted with a projection of an 8% increase in revenue in the sanitation fund. Does anybody sitting here know how that's going to happen?
No, but
because nobody proposed a plan as to how to realize that gain. So generally the way that enterprise funds work is you have to generate enough revenue to cover your costs. And those are generally done by user fees. And we learned nothing from last year when we lost a quarter of the increase in the sewer rate because we didn't communicate with other departments about things that were being proposed in the 2019 budget.
Right, but
so one of the things that we need to start discussing, in which can be done in a much shorter time frame than some of these other projects, is talking about the sanitation fees, which have not been touched since 2012.
Well, and there we go again. We're looking at sanitation fees, which can go up, and you're saying, you know, I want to see the data on that because I know my sanitation fees have gone up since 2012, and so has the water fees. Now, if that's not true, I want to see it in writing. And again, here we go, talking about, hold on, it's my turn. We're talking about increasing sanitation fees, and you don't have bulk garbage pickup. So we're taking away services, but we want to keep increasing the fees. And I'm sick of it. Same thing with the water. We done paid all this money for water that was contaminated, and we need to know where's that water fund and those rebate checks.
Well, look,
Michelle, because...
Everything
goes up and our services go down.
Costs go up and we're not planning for those costs. And if sanitation fees went up since 2012, then there's a problem in the code because the code has never been changed.
Well, I want to see the data on that because I think that those sanitation fees have gone up more recently.
The stop fee has been $2.75 since
2012. So has the water. We got a resolution for the water fees to go up too.
No, the water fees, the per quarter water fee has not been changed at all.
Don't we have a resolution to increase the water fees?
That's sewer.
Sewer.
Yeah, it's sewer.
Okay, water, sewer, and sanitation, all in the same boat.
So,
but that's the model that mm-hmm. those enterprise funds operate under.
Right.
And you can only accomplish so much in a cost reduction. Costs continue to go up. And if you don't address the associated way of raising revenue, what I'm saying is that you would, that the budget that was presented proposed an increase in revenue without any way of realizing that revenue, and now we find out that there was a deficit in a previous year and that our costs have increased in depositing the right. garbage that we pick right. up. So there's a huge breakdown in communication about how these enterprise funds are operating.
Thank
and
you.
That's not being addressed.
Right. Thank you. Right. So that goes back to a further conversation that I know that Councilmember Mejia, I know that I have had it and possibly others have had it, that our departments need to communicate with one another better. So that we avoid this. This also goes back to a conversation that I've had with Mr. Donat just very, very briefly about better planning for our revenues, because I need for every single department to be working collaboratively together, to also be thinking about revenue, but not just projecting it, to have some actual plans on how they're going to get that revenue. You know, for the sake of time and for everything else, I don't know if it's appropriate for us to do this back and forth, but there are some things, you know, I'm very happy with the budget that we passed. I think it's a sound budget, but there are some things that now that we passed that budget that we still need to do our due diligence on making sure that come next year, we're in a better position for that next budget.
But you're correct about that, but there are things that we did put in. We put in for sanitation enforcement officers to go do these things, to go after recycling. It was taken out. So it's twofold here. There are department heads that did put in for other things, for things to be raised to cover costs, and they get put in. I mean, simple things like with code compliance. They can't even come in on a Saturday and Sunday to do that if they wanted to, because you gave them $1,000 in overtime for the year. How?
Crazy.
You can't, when other departments are spending millions of dollars a year in overtime, and the departments that you need to come in and do these things to bring revenue back into the city, we can't have them do it.
George, I know we're aware of the problem, and I think we need, you know, hopefully we pass the budget, that's going to get us through another year, but we do have to focus on, you know, bringing revenue into the city. We need to look at all the fees. I think we had a list of, you know, fees that haven't been raised in a while, permit fees, building permit fees, whatever, but we need to go through the list and look at where we can, you know, possibly bring in revenue. Also, the parking meters are archaic. We need to, you know, replace those with newer ones where you can just, you know, you don't need quarters. So, and our parking committee. We have parking lots that we're not really enforcing, and we're not having people who are using the parking lots pay to use them. So,
right, I agree. I also want to say, because we talked about this in our caucus recently, but the point is, like, when you look at those fees with parking, code enforcement just as well, I got a list of landlords with violations, and they're not being you know, called to task with those fees. Then I got a list of people who have parking tickets, and they're not being enforced, you know, and then it's through the parking enforcement. And I talked to Chief Solomon about that. It's just like if you look at what Wayne's department is doing with water, right? He got this technology, and he's found all these leak detections with water, and how many thousands of gallons of water that the city was losing with these leaks. And they fixed them, and it became a significant cost savings to the city. That's the same way you got to look at when you got code enforcement and you're citing these landlords because they're in violation, and nobody's following up to get the money, right? And the same thing with code enforcement. Parking enforcement. If we have people with tickets, I know a young man who's got tickets upon tickets, and we keep sending the letters out, and they owe like 10 tickets, and they say, well, I'm not paying it. And the reason why is because there has to be some sort of connection between a parking ticket and the Department of Motor Vehicle. If you suspend a person's license, if they don't pay a parking fee, they're going to pay that parking fee. So all of this stuff that we're talking about, even with the shared services, with millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars in Orange County for shared services, we haven't tapped into it once. It's all about following through, following up, going back, making sure people are paying for those violations on the code enforcement, parking enforcement, and going to Orange County with Mrs. Anderson and saying, hey, we really need those funds for those shared services. What have you guys decided upon? You're going to provide all the municipalities in Orange County. It's all about follow-up. And I'm going to tell you,
that's about management. That's management. Bottom line.
Because
management.
The people sitting behind this table, $9,000 a year.
Sheesh.
And let me tell you something. When we try to even have a discussion, I even asked the city manager to give a $1,000 raise to the council members, including the mayor, all right? Everybody looked at me like I had 10 heads. And the
Not
city
me.
Manager never even put it in his final proposed budget, neither did Mr. Duffy. And I asked Mr. Duffy to put that extra $1,000 in our salary, because guess what we had to become? We had to become budget analyst. Okay, now we got to do enforcement. Now we got to follow up on. So the council members are being asked to do all this. And it's like, wait a minute. When did we become budget analysts? When did we have to study and read and dig into the budget when the manager's proposed budget was a 7.1% increase in taxes? But we all rolled up our sleeves, all the council members, including Michelle Mills, and found $70,000 of errors, of human errors in the budget. With salary scales and all that. We had to go all, you know, the last 2-3 months, it's been, you know what? With time for the council members, and we get $9,000. So now we're being asked to follow up on shared service funding. We're asking to be following up on code enforcement and making sure people pay these fees. We're being asked to follow up now on parking money that is owed. There's thousands of dollars, hundreds of thousands of dollars owed to this city, and we got a budget shortfall in sanitation. But what ends up happening is we go to the easy solution and say, oh, we're going to tax the people or raise up the fees in sanitation, but we're going to keep taking away their services. That ain't happening.
That's fine. Forensic audit.
If people aren't going to be doing their jobs and being held accountable, you got to go.
It starts with the leader, and that's what's missing. So,
come on, man. We're going to keep increasing the fees, sanitation fees for the taxpayers when we got hundreds of thousands of dollars out in tickets and code enforcement, tickets and parking enforcement. We got meters that are probably from the 1950s on our streets. When you go to Poughkeepsie or you go to Middletown, they got the meters where you put in your credit card and you get a ticket and put it in the window. And that's in Poughkeepsie. It's digital.
It's a muni meter. And
come on.
Look, you have lots of points. You have lots of points. But at the end of the day, you know, budget oversight is a council responsibility. And the state comptroller has said that in multiple audits.
So quick question. So just really quickly following up on the parking thing. We have one that's electronic that has not gotten installed, right? So we're going on a 2.5-year delay on the installation of that. So again, you know, sometimes I think I'm not speaking English for middle ground solutions that get brought up at the council table. One of them was Whoosh for parking, right? Kingston has that. We can keep the current meters that we have. It isn't required to do a whole, you know, infrastructure change to be able to do that. It's an app. You just put a sticker on the current meters, and if you got quarters, you put your quarters in. If you got an app, you do it via the app. So that was one easy solution, mm-hmm. at least to begin to address that. The other thing was, have we heard back from, I hate to even ask, right, from OSC, about our submitted budget?
I have not. Bond Council left me a voicemail message on Wednesday. I returned the call, but I haven't gotten a call back. I have no idea whether that's related to the State Comptroller's Office or not. So I'm not aware of any further information from the State Comptroller's Office.
I would imagine
that in light of the Comptroller's resignation in September, that the parking tribunal probably has not been organized for the remainder of the year, and that's going to affect parking ticket collection as well.
Okay. So then, you know, to folks that are watching and the folks who are here in the audience, this is like we are undergoing what I didn't think we would be going through, a very interesting transition of leadership. What I want to say to Corporation Council is I just want to tell you thank you, because I think in the last months you have really super stretched yourself so that the city can continue to move forward, and I just want to say thanks to that. And I think that sometimes when we get passionate about things from this side of the table, you hear it in our tone, you hear it in the exchange that we do, but it's coming, I like to think it's coming 90% of the time, from a good place that we want to continue to move forward. So, and I got to tell you, I am still pumped about this RUBCO project, which is why I'm going on the positive side of wanting to prep for 2019. So to the staff who's here during this transitional period, you know, I think you're going to start to see an improvement around communications. And you guys have to talk to one another too, you know, and we got to figure out how to do that across departments. And, you know, the council needs to talk to each other as well. I chose to run for office because I wanted to serve my community, and it's a very limited time that we have. Our structure, the city manager system, you know, it's a conversation that we need to have, because I firmly believe down, deep down inside, from it just, it doesn't function in our city. It's not the proper method, but it's the method that we have, and it's the method that we have to continue to operate under until that changes. So during this transitional period, you know, you department heads, you have been here through different iterations of city managers, and you continue to be here because you have a commitment to the city. So I would just want for us to over-communicate, even if it's for the, you know, most simplest things of like, hey, I left the lights on, and hey, you're getting paved tomorrow, and you should know that. And we need to do that and just be a little kinder to one another during this transitional period. And it's, you know, way past a time that we're all not, I don't think we're at our best.
Yeah. Also, I want to thank you, Michelle, as well.
Council, if I may add just a comment or two. The budget was posted up on our website today, so I expect that the Office of the State Comptroller has it to review, and I will be confirming with the examiner that they're on receipt of it tomorrow. And as far as the sanitation fund, the Commissioner Garrison and I have met with our collector, Ms. DeMora, and started working on a presentation for you. I just put some points on the paper I distributed a few minutes ago, and what we intend to present to you at a future session, most likely in January, is talking about how to address the tipping fee increase, a way to resolve the recurring budget deficit that is in the sewer fund, sanitation fund currently. What we want to do is present how sanitation is billed to actually document and show the $3 million of revenue that has been in our budget for the sanitation fund since 2014, I saw in the book. Since 2012, so even before the book that I saw. And then also, like we were just talking about, presenting alternative revenue options, including enforcement that you were diving into, and recycling with the conversation that we had. And then finally, presenting an analysis. One of the ideas you had of just reducing the expenses is to, as Councilman Grice was talking about, you know, having the lids that are closed so that the weight tonnage is down, and possibly larger container sizes so there aren't so many cans that need to be used. And these analyses will help us address both the expense side and the revenue side, and we look forward to presenting that to you. Thank you.
And when will that be ready?
We were...
First work session in January.
First work session? Yeah. I was working with Collector DeMora, and I think we can have an analysis of the how it's billed by then also.
Okay, so if there's nothing further on 22, we'll go to item 23.
And so I guess that segues into 23, so I'll let you speak to that first before I make any comments.
Shouldn't it be the city manager?
Sorry, I didn't hear you, Councilman.
No, go. It's late. Go.
So item 23 is relating to Charlie Duffy's work as a financial consultant for the city. As you are aware, his contract expires on December 31st. For continuity's sake, in recognition of the circumstances under which Mr. Duffy came in and grabbed the data the best he could to formulate the city manager's budget, it would be my recommendation that contract be extended at a minimum. I also would just state advocating for Mr. Duffy that the council consider naming him as at least the acting or interim comptroller while the new city manager is seated and is enabled to make a choice of their own based on the resumes that we've thus far collected.
Well, I think that it would be appropriate for our prospective interim city manager to be a part of that discussion.
Yeah.
Who will be or serve as an interim, and I'd like to also have this discussion in executive session, because it is dealing with a personnel matter, because there are some, and I'm going to say it publicly, there are some concerns as the mayor that I have that have been communicated to me regarding individuals that work in the comptroller's office with Mr. Duffy. So, that's all I'll say publicly. And so I think that these kinds of personnel matters need to be handled in an executive session, number one. And I think that we all pretty much know that Mr. Joe Dona is gonna serve in the capacity of interim city manager. And I think once that happens, that transition happens, he should be a part of the discussion of the comptroller's office and the other vacancy in the executive offices.
Okay.
Thank you.
I support that too.
Yes.
So do I. Being that you have mentioned Mr. Joseph Donat, is it possible that I can have his resume? I don't know anything about him. I know I wasn't here for
it. It was distributed, emailed to all of us. You don't have
the
it?
The email?
Yes.
Can I have a hard copy, though?
Sure.
Thank you.
Oh, he has an extra copy.
Thank you.
So that was the last item on the agenda. And is there a motion to adjourn?
So move.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Aye.